right? So the first chapter, 1.1, is just a brief introduction to vectors, and actually the entire chapter 1 is going to be an introduction to three-dimensional geometry. So it's not properly speaking calculus. There are a few sections there that are not properly speaking calculus. It takes forever to get to properly speaking calculus. So basically, first we can consider everything as generated by a line that has a direction and magnitude. So for instance, you take some piece of space that is oriented. I mean, you can see it's oriented relative to a two-dimensional space like it's here. And this is going to generate a coordinate system. So in other words, a vector, you can be thinking about it as just a segment of line with the direction that generates a coordinate system. The positive numbers are corresponding to to future times, you can think of it in terms of time. So zero is where you're looking at right now, and then the particle is traveling in some moment of time, 1 second, let's say, to this position onwards. And if you go backwards in time, you have minus one, minus two, etc. So if you select, in other words, any segment with a direction, that generates a line, a linear space. So there is a way to generate a two-dimensional space or a planar space. All you do is just introduce another line, right? And then you would have this lattice of lines. Notice that I specifically did not draw them perpendicular to each other. One thing where I deviate in my notes from the book is where I just try to establish that that there are other coordinate systems, and sometimes you will prefer those for graphing, for easier formulas, for visualization. Sometimes those are better, but not all. Right? I mean, depends on the equation. Depends on what you want to say. So first, before we even consider how those spaces are constructed, we talk about vectors. So a vector is just a displacement from one point in space to another point in space. And what we mean by displacement is really we don't track at all how the motion from point A to point B is happening. We just take note of the initial position and the final position. And then we just imagine drawing a straight line, and we can imagine that this straight line is just pointing by how far you have to fly from point A to point B, and in what direction you have to move. Now both things are somewhat ambiguous. Direction and magnitude are just primitives. We just imagine that we understand them. We don't explain them at the moment. Don't explain them any further. Now the picture below illustrates that when we think about vectors as opposed to points in space, we don't really care where those vectors are, right? So point A can be here, or it could be here, I call it A prime. And point B can be here, or we can have another point B prime. Those two vectors, A and B, are the same vectors. Why? Because they are parallel. That means that they have the same direction. You see, the arrows are, there's another word that's called anti-parallel. We're going to see that later. So parallel means that the lines are parallel, like in geometry, and we also have this that they are directed in the same direction. So the arrows point in the same place. And the other thing is that you can see that they're all the same magnitude. In other words, if you can take a directed line segment and translate it somewhere else in space, then you would say that other place where you translate it is the same vector. So really, a vector is the, if you speak about higher math, it's the equivalence class of all translates of directed line segments. So this is just a very silly illustration of that. So vector A and vector B are not equal. Why are they not equal?
Magnitude is different.
Magnitude is different, exactly. So it appears that they have the same direction, but not the same magnitude. So displacement is not of the same size. In two, they are not equal because they do have the same magnitude but opposite direction. So this is called anti-parallel, right? Because they are pointing in opposite directions. The word is anti-parallel. Now here they are the same because B is the translate of A. Okay? Clear? Now this drawing illustrates how addition is to take place. So if I think of vectors or displacement, then I don't know, I don't take note of any of the intermediate points where I stop, right? Like for instance, if I had to draw a vector from my home to Hunter College, I don't take the points where my brother traveled at all, right? I don't know those points. I just draw a straight line. So this is the initial point, and then you can see that there was some point B where we stopped, and that is the vector A to B. And then from point B, we displaced further by some vector from which we designate by the letters B and C. Right? Now, A plus AB to plus BC has to be then the displacement total from A to C. The total displacement from A to C. And we do that by just noting the initial point of the entire trip and the final, and we draw a directed line. There? Now, even with those things, you have to right away start asking yourself, is addition necessarily commutative? Is it always the case that A plus B the same as B plus C? Now, you might be saying it's obvious that they are the same, but it's not, because A plus B is the description of one trip that you are taking, but B plus C is a description of a completely different trip that you are taking. You are visiting different points. So imagine that you are traveling from village A to village C in some beautiful countryside. So if you are traveling by further displacing to village B, that would be the vector A plus B, right? So you first travel to the village B, and then you travel to the village C. So you can see that physically the space takes you through a different landscape. Whereas here, if you travel first through the vector B and then through the vector A, it takes you through a different landscape. But the end result, based on this drawing, because what you generate is a parallelogram. A is parallel to A, B is parallel to B, which means that that it's a parallelogram and they meet at the same point. Geometrically, it seems obvious. And that indicates that B plus A and A plus B is the same displacement. Because again, displacement doesn't take note of any intermediate points, only initial and final points. Clear? So this is, again, indication that A plus B and B plus A is exactly the same vector. Because it indicates the same displacement, but not the same itinerary of travel. Now, for any vector A, I mean, first of all, we can consider the vector 0. So what would you consider the vector 0 to be, to indicate what? Well, a point is, again, we have to, you're almost correct. The thing about a point is a point that does not have direction, right? And does not indicate a trip. So a vector, let's say, has to indicate some displacement. So if I have 0, what does it mean? What was my initial place where I started my trip? Some point. And I returned to the same point. So the trip could have been complicated, or I could have stayed at the same point. Doesn't matter, right? So I call this vector 0. And it's not clear what direction should a point have. So 0 can either be said that it's directionless, or better, you can say it assumes the direction that you want it to assume. So you can assign the 0 vector any direction you need it to assign, right? So that it's going to be easily added to any other vector. You understand? So what we consider in this drawing is just how do we create the additive inverse for a vector. So given a vector A, how should I find a vector B such that the sum is 0? Well, it's pretty clear that one way to do that is I can first displace from A to B by the vector A. So just select a point at which you start your trip. You travel to point B. And then at point B, I just need to travel exactly back. So that drawing indicates that the additive inverse of A is just that vector A, take its direction and rotate it 180 degrees. In other words, take it and flip it. In other words, they are anti-parallel. They are of the same size. They are pointing in opposite directions. And that would be how you construct additive inverse for any vector A. Okay? So basically right now, the way you construct the negative of the vector, you just take the vector, and instead of the arrow being here, you switch it so the other points in the opposite direction. So what this is supposed to illustrate is that addition of vectors is associative, also something that is not as obvious, right? So I defined what it means to add two vectors at a time, not three vectors at a time, right? So potentially, basically, if I have a plus b that I consider first this string, and then plus c, that might be a different different vector than if I have a plus b plus c. You see, that's what this this is illustrating. So for instance, if this is a and this is b, then a plus b, in other words, I consider first displacing here, and then displacing by c. So my trip is this, and then that. That's what this describes, right? This describes the trip, which is taken as first a plus b, and then c. On the other hand, you see this is supposed to be the same road, right? And here we have first a, we travel first by a, and then b plus c. So first traveling by a, and here is b plus c, so that would be this vector. And again, you can see that you should arrive at the same exact location. Right, this is not a proof, this is a still kind of geometric, I don't know what you call it, right? Geometric demonstration. So proofs are, again, you need an algebraic description of what a vector is so that you can describe it analytically. So what those two drawings are supposed to tell you is that it doesn't matter, I can just write, I might as well just like with numbers, write a plus b plus c without indication of what I must sum first. And this drawing, again, this drawing here indicates how displacement works. So this is some sort of trip that has been taken, maybe by my brother, right? Here, etc., right? It's a complicated combination of motions, but the end result is the displacement from the initial point to the final point, right? So let's say if you have a good grasp of what's happening. Suppose, I don't want to reveal too much, can this be seen? Here. I don't want to reveal too much. Suppose somebody made this drop, right? What is the total displacement? What's the sum of all the vectors shown in the picture?
Zero.
Why? Because again, all you care is that where you started and where you end up. All the displacements bring you back to the same point where you started. Perfect. So the sum is zero. And now it begins to be basically one of the important things of vector geometry is it's very useful in kinematics. It's very useful in describing the motion of objects. That's what Calc-3 is going to do. It's going to try to describe the motions of objects in three-dimensional space. One of the things, right? It's going to try to do. So this idea is trying to tell you how to think of a line, right? So you can think of a line as generated by a particle that is traveling with some constant velocity, right? So and then the numbers on the line indicate the times when the particle arrives in different locations. So for instance, at zero, that's where the particle is now. A is the velocity of the particle. So let's say A is the distance and direction of a units per second. So 1 second later, it's going to be in this location. 2 seconds later, it's going to be in this location, etc. And then we can, in the same way, extrapolate what happened in the past. We can go 1 second to the past, 2 seconds in the past, etc. Right? So notice what that indicates. Notice that 2 times the vector a, right, is really twice times the magnitude, right? So if I multiply a vector by a positive number, let's say a positive integer 2, then I increase the vector to twice the size. If I multiply the vector by 3, I increase the vector to 3 times the size, right? What happens if I multiply a vector by 1/2?
You reduce it by 1/2.
You reduce it in half, right? So is that clear, or I missed something or jumped some explanation?
You said multiply by 1.
By a number, right? So basically, in this description, we consider what it means to multiply a vector by a number. There are going to be a bunch of products that we need to consider in Calc 3. The first thing we need to understand is what it means to multiply a vector by a scalar, by a number, right? So the analogy of the particle is that the scalar is the time, right? So basically, if you take a vector and multiply it by 1, you get back that vector, right? If you multiply a vector by 2, it's the same as the vector a plus a, right? Take a vector times 2, it's the same as a plus a. So it's twice, basically here is a, and here is another a. So it's twice, it's basically twice in magnitude, but keeping the same direction. Three times, it means I had an extra copy of a, right? So a very natural thing to do is then to ask what it means to multiply a vector by fractions. If I multiply a vector by, say, 1/2, I have the vector. Okay? So basically, multiplying by a positive number does not alter the direction of the vector, only the size. Okay? Now, if I multiply a vector by negative numbers, what should happen? They reverse the direction, right? Now again, if I kind of jump through it, so forgive me. I actually don't even remember what I wrote. But basically, if you look at the slide, that's how parametric descriptions are done, right? So basically, you can think of this particle as having position in time. So the position in time is, let's say, we have here some point in time is. Or we can think of it as t times times the vector a. So if I select t equals 0, that means that's where the particle is now, right? So t equals 0, again, I don't really write it right now because we need to indicate position. We haven't yet learned how to indicate position, supposedly, right? So that's the problem, right? So I suppose if I select the appropriate coordinate systems where the position is indicated by, let's say, 0, then when t is equal to 0, that would be where the particle is now. Now, as I increase in time, as the drawing illustrates, what would happen is that the particle is just traveling. It's traveling with a constant velocity. So 1 second later, it has traveled to position B. 2 seconds later, it has traveled to position C. What's clear is that if it's constant velocity, then you know, if it's moving along this dotted line with constant speed, then basically it would generate a number line with equal spaced segments. So that would be like a unit. So in relative to this drawing, a unit, basically the number 1 is going to be interpreted as 1 times the vector, 1 times the size of the vector. 2 is 2 times the size of the vector. 3 is 3 times the size of the vector. In essence, what I'm saying is that scalars are really, if you take a ruler, a scalar is just basically the locations relative to the number line generated by that vector. And negative numbers, they generate it in opposite direction. Because you see, to go in the negative, basically what you see, you just take this vector and just go in negative velocity. And then you would move backwards. So, so multiplication of vectors, well, here you have the example. So if A is this vector, just this line, this size and direction, minus A is just going to be the same size, it's going to be antiparallel, opposite direction. Now, if I select a constant T that is bigger than 0 and smaller than 1, it's going to take the vector, keep the direction, but shorten it, right? Multiplying by some fraction or by a number t smaller than 1. If t is smaller than 1, we are somewhere in here, right? It's like asking where the particle is at, let's say, half a second. If the particle is traveling at constant speed, and it travels from town A to town B, then at 0 seconds, it's in town A. At 1 second, it's in town B. And if it travels at half the speed, at 1/2 second, it's going to be halfway between those two towns. Right? Halfway, what does it mean? It means that the displacement has size half of this interval from 0 to 1, right? And still the same direction. And if you ask where is it, where has it been before, it's really the same as displacing by the anti-parallel quantity of that vector. In other words, by this vector reversed the direction. Okay? So the vector is made longer if you multiply it by a scalar bigger than 1. Okay? And it's made longer, and the direction is changed if you multiply by a scalar that is smaller than minus 1. Clear? This picture here is supposed to illustrate that multiplication and addition of vectors, basically multiplication is distributive through addition of vectors. So what this is saying is, suppose I want to calculate k times the sum of a plus b. So in red you see a and b. So a plus b is this vector. Right? I chose k to be, in this case, clearly smaller than 1. You could do a similar picture for k bigger than 1, right? If k is smaller than 1, then let's see what's happening. So k times a is going to be a vector. In this case, k is still positive, right? So it's a vector that is going to be in the same direction, but shorter than a. And kb is going to be a vector in the same direction as b, but shorter than b. And you can look at this picture. The angles of ka makes with kb is the same as the angle that a makes with b. Right? So basically, this angle here is the same as this angle here. They are the same angles, right? This is just a scalar it's a scalar multiple. So those two triangles you can just see are proportional because we have this side is a scalar multiple of A and this side is a scalar multiple of B. So by that we have proportionality. That tells us that the triangles, this triangle here and the bigger red triangle, are proportional. That tells us that k times a plus k times b lies along the line generated by the vector a plus b. Right? So the sum of this plus that is, so it has to be, because the triangles are proportional and this side is multiplied, this is just k times a and this is k times b, then this remaining side, ka plus kb, has to be the same as k times a plus b. That's by proportionality. So it's not obvious, right? It's by proportionality. Clear? So that tells us that, in other words, what this picture is supposed to prove is that k times a plus b, where k is just a number, a scalar, is the same as k times a plus k times b. So here is a comprehension check that it's very important. It's going to be important when we talk about the dot product, if you want to understand it. How are we to understand how to geometrically construct the vector a minus b? So what this is telling us to do is, what we can do is we can take the vector a and the vector b tail to tail. And then we take the head of B and connect it by an arrow to the head of A. And the resulting vector is A minus B. Now why is that? Well, let's think about addition. Here is B. Here is A. If I draw a vector from the tail of B to the head of A, and just call it C for a moment, right, there is a displacement from B to C. So what this drawing tells you is that B plus C is equal to A. Right? Now we already established something about vector geometry. So look what we can do. What I can do is I can subtract a from both sides. And again, guys, make sure that you see why what I'm doing is justified. It's not numbers, right, that we're using. So we have this, and we subtract a. And since this is basically the same as taking A and subtracting A from it. Well, what this means is basically minus A is a vector generated in the opposite direction as A. So we know that A minus A is just a trip that you take a straight line from some point to another and then back. So this displacement is zero. So this is the zero vector. This is the zero vector, right? Now, I can distribute, and I can write this as B minus A plus C, which is zero. Now I can do that because of associativity that we established, right? It doesn't matter in which order I add them, and it doesn't matter if I commute the vectors, right? We saw that one vector plus another is the same as the other vector plus the first. I did it a bit clumsy, but I hope you can forgive me, because I show you that minus C is equal to minus A plus B. Now, what is this? This is the same thing as, I can think of this by law of distributivity, I can think of this as minus 1, and I can write here A minus B. So it's minus 1 times A minus B. That's because we have distributivity, which we kind of hinted at geometrically. And by doing the same procedure, by subtracting C from here, I can write it as minus 1 times C. So I can cancel the minus 1s and I have it. So I know that C is the vector I wanted to produce. I did it a bit clumsily. You can do it faster and better, by the way, right? With fewer motions. But I hope you follow the idea. Mm-hmm.
C is going to be negative in the y since you.
So basically that's why I divide by minus 1. Basically my goal is to show that A minus B is the vector C.
Okay.
Right? Which you can do other ways. I mean, I actually have some explanation that I wrote here. So I would have gone over that, but again, I don't remember what I ever wrote. All right, so next what we need to talk about is, it's really right now not even a formula. We don't know what it does. We just have a notation for the size of a vector. So the size of vector is, in other words, if I want to only indicate the magnitude, only the length of it, not really where it's directed, I do this. In later math, you actually only use absolute value, because it's really a generalization of absolute value. For instance, if you read that favorite book of mine, Analysis of Manifolds, he would not distinguish between absolute value and this double bar symbol. So this is size of A. The language for that, they call it norm, the norm of A, right? So let's look at a comprehension, very silly question. Is this a scalar, in other words, a number or a vector?
Scalar,
right? Because really, although we had initially a vector, we are only interested now in its length. Whatever that means, length relative to what? You need to specify a ruler to measure length. No ruler is yet specified. That's one thing. You should understand that there is no inherent ruler. I can measure things in kilometers, or in meters, or in centimeters, so there is no inherent ruler. So when you specify size, you must specify what you mean by unit size, at least, right? What is the unit of a ruler? All right. So question 3, we want to know which of the following are vectors and which are not defined. All right, so A, will that be a vector?
Yeah.
Because we have some displacement A, in order to say, okay, you see this finger? That's a displacement. Now, in order to get to where you need to go, move the same magnitude of this finger, but three times. In other words, you imagine to extending this finger by taking this chunk, measuring here's another, and here's another, and then it points to some point where you should arrive at. And then displace an extra three times B. So that's a vector. What about that?
Yes.
Yes. What about this?
Yes.
Yes. Why do you nod your head all the time? Why yes? Have I even talked about it? No. What does it even mean? Undefined, unclear, not explained. No idea. I didn't have anything. I just wrote A and B. Some product. I didn't even speak about products, right? So, right now, undefined. What about this? Again. Undefined, right? I mean, you would want it to be zero, maybe, but in what sense?
No, I'm asking if that is a zero.
That's a zero. Yes, it is a zero. But it's a zero vector, and there is some sort of multiplication that I didn't explain. So, first of all, undefined. There's nothing to even think about. What about E?
You see.
That's zero.
Now, what this means is, now notice, there is no arrow. So, that indicates a scalar, a number, 0 times A.
That is
0. Now, why is that 0? It's not obvious. I mean, it should not be obvious. So what we have is 0 times A. Right? Where this 0 is a scalar. Now, what can we do with 0? We can write 0 as 0 plus 0 times A. Right? And there is, I'm not sure if I actually just glossed over that, there is another distribution, right? Distributivity. I showed you that a scalar distributes through a sum of two vectors. I haven't yet shown you that a vector distributes through a sum of two scalars, right? But you can believe me, it's very similar. You can do it yourself. So what we have here is 0 times A plus 0 times A. In other words, 0 times A is 0 times A plus 0 times A. Now what I can do, I can subtract the vector. 0 times A, and I obtain 0 vector 0 equal to 0 times A. What I do is I subtract here. And the vector minus itself is the 0 displacement. Because a vector minus itself means displaced by the vector, and then go back by the same displacement in reverse. Okay, so that's zero by definition, right? Minus zero times A is really this, whatever this vector is. You just take that vector, flip it over. So when you add them together, you are back in the same place you started from. So that is zero. Now what we have here, we have three terms that we add. Remember that we can add those two and then that, or we can add those two and then that, right? So that's why but that's what we do, we just do this. This is canceled to zero, the zero vector, and we get that. Clear? So zero times, it is the zero vector, defined. What about F? Is that a vector?
It's a unit vector.
Yes, so it is a unit vector in case A is not 0. So it's a vector unless the vector A is 0. In other words, if it has a non-zero size, it makes sense to divide by a scalar. Dividing by a scalar is the same as multiplying by 1 over that scalar. Yeah?
So basically, that has a limit?
A limit?
Yeah.
We don't talk about limits yet, geometry, no limits. Limits is when, here is the idea of limits, right? Limit is when you are, let's say, my analogy to a limit is when I lived in Israel, there was this one-armed machine that used to grab toys, right? Now you have to throw a coin, maybe a shekel or some sort of money, so that it works. But I figured out that you could plug in some sort of worthless coin that you have a lot of, much, much cheaper, or, you know, like, let's say, if one shekel is 100, let's say, like cents, right? You could have plugged that, and this thing worked, right? So this machine is not sensitive. So a limit is basically when you take a machine, and instead of putting into the machine what it wants, you put something that is ever more similar, a counterfeit, right? So when you speak about limits, there must be something that is impostering, impersonating something else. So for instance, when I say limit as x goes to 0 of, let's say, x squared, right? So a lot of people, when they do calculus, they just say, well, what you do is you plug 0 instead of x. No, they're wrong. What do you plug? You plug a counterfeit of 0. Right? So what you're saying is, OK, x is going to be made to look ever more similar to 0. And that's what you put in. You understand? So we'll talk about limits later. But right now, there are no limits. Right now, all it is just we have a multiplied by a scalar 1 over e. Clear. A over norm of A is 1 over A times A. That's what it means, right? So, and this is a scalar. And this is a vector. And the operation is usually defined. When is it undefined? When the scalar is 0, when the scalar is 1 over 0. So usually it's defined, but not always, with the exception of 0. Good? All right, so we're moving fast. That's nice. All right. What else? Now, g. Is g a vector, a scalar, or undefined?
Vector,
right? It is a vector because what you see is you see vector operations, right? What can we do to preserve it from you know, to preserve it in being a vector? If we multiply a vector by any scalar, that's fine. If we combine them by adding or subtracting, that's fine. So what we have is a times the norm of a times b is a vector. The norm of b times a is a vector. So now we have a difference of two vectors, and that's a perfectly well-defined operation. Good. Again, guys, sorry if I move fast. If you are stuck or something is confusing, I'll be happy to explain. So now we talk about coordinates, right? So coordinates, that's one thing that is very hard to, it's very easy. The idea is really very easy, but sometimes hard to just explain in a clear way. And that one thing that I think the book that you have and many other calculus books don't bother. But it's pretty important. So you can think of coordinates as being generated by some vector. So in other words, imagine primitively taking a stick and orienting it in space. Somewhere instead of what I'm holding here, you can see it's, here's that stick, right? And okay, that stick is going to be now unit 1. Right? In other words, displacement from here to here, that's my measurement of size 1. That's what you do with centimeters or inches, etc. You just select some segment of stick and say, that's going to be my measurement. In the biblical times, they used to measure things, so they call it amma, or the, what do you call this, the what? What do you, I always forget the English word.
Forearm?
Forearm, thank you, right? Yeah, so that thing, the forearm, is how they used to measure it. So I suppose you take the standard forearm of a standard biblical person, and that's how you build, let's say, of Noah, for instance, right? And that's how you measure the size of the ark. So the same thing is done here, right? We just pick our arbitrary segment, a linear segment, give it a direction. So let's say where the cap is, that's the head of the vector, and that's the beginning, and generate the number line, right? So we fix this vector in space at some point in space, in geometric space, that we consider to be the origin of that system. That's where it's fixed, right? So 0 of that system means the point A. 1 of that system means displaced from A by one directed line segment. 2 means really 2 times A displaced from A. Right? Construct 2 times A such that the tail of that vector is at capital A. And that's how you generate the positive terms of the number line. You understand? How do I generate the negative terms of the number line? I do exactly the same thing, but in reverse. So minus 1 means minus a. So construct itself so that the tail of that vector lies at this point here. and minus 2 is just twice the size of that vector in the opposite direction, etc. Okay? So when you, well, that's basically a translation of coordinates. Look at it. Every point on this line is a geometric point. Well, is now has an address. So the point 1 now has an address. I know how to locate it. I just have to displace by that distance. 2 has an address, etc. Right? So address to translate 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. to locations in space. Like, it's pretty much like zip code. It's exactly how it works. Right? You need to then convert the number 1 to a physical thing, to a line segment that you're going to place at this at the center of your coordinate system, at A, which you just arbitrarily selected, and that's how you know how to find the geometric location of 1. To find 1/2, what you do is you just take this, you cut it in half. And that's how you find the address corresponding to 1/2. Right? By themselves, numbers don't have geometric significance. Right? That's the difference between scalars. Scalars don't have geometric significance, vectors do. Here you can see a difference, right? So here we selected two different vectors. And in this case, I selected as my unit length. Notice I also made them in opposite direction. I selected a directed line segment B. Right? It looks like it's in size, it's twice as A. You can see it because it corresponds to 2, right? So in this case, the number 1 corresponds to the displacement by the vector B from the central point A. You see, it gives you a different address, different geometric address to the same points. Good? No, not confused yet. You will. You will. Right, so one of the things that I hope my explanation will simplify is it will make you recognize how to describe parallelograms or parallelepipeds, because those are going to be the building blocks of our two-dimensional, three-dimensional objects. The easiest thing, if you think about Lego blocks, right, is you see some artists do that, right? They just take and build statues out of Lego blocks. If you consider trying to find the volume of an object, the easiest volume of a geometric shape might be that of a box, right? And the next easiest may be that of a box that you twist it or torque it somehow. So if we can figure out how to find volumes of those objects, we can try to extrapolate and find volumes of more complicated structure by just imagining them as being built out of the simple structures. So back to that coordinate system. So you learned how to graph the points. Let's say you have a pair of points. So let's say 1 and 2, right? 1, 2. So somebody told you in school right now, well, find the location of that point. What do? You right away instinctually do this. You think, So we have some y-axis, we have some x-axis. So here is 1, here is 2, and the point is here. Why did you do that? That's because you assume that that the coordinate system is generated by perpendicular vectors of equal size. So you assume that basically what you do is you take a unit stick here, and the same size unit stick on the y-axis, and you place them tail to tail perpendicular to each other. So this unit stick generates the x-axis, the other one generates the y-axis. But by itself, there is no information on how to locate this address. The more general thing to do is, let's say somebody did not specify that they have to be of the same size and they have to be orthogonal. Let's say that what happened is that the location is going to be, so basically you're specified two directions. You are specified the vector A, and you are specified the vector B. So that's how they are oriented in space. And you are specified a point A at which you begin your journey. So then you can have here is 1B, 1, so in other words, 1 is 1b, 2 is 2b, 3 is 3b, and in the opposite direction, all the same, right? That's what happens when you generate a vector from A. But, and then what we can do is we can take the vector A and generate another line. And the result is a skewed coordinate system. Notice, I'm not sure what, if it's clear on the drawing, I'm not assuming that the size of A is the same as the size of B. But basically, the coordinate AB, and the coordinate SD, will then be interpreted as a displacement from location A in space by the vector S times A plus T times B. Is that clear? That's exactly the same thing as you are doing when you consider rectangular coordinates. So here is how this is illustrated here. So for instance, here, I want you to locate the point 2, 1. The point 2, 1 can only be understood relative to that grid, right? So we have this vector A and the vector B. So the vector A is generated this way, the vector B generates the line this way. And that's the central point from where you begin. So 2, 1 means this is the point obtained by displacing from the center of that coordinate system by twice A, and then by once by B. So your motion is, again, always parallel to lines generated by the vector A and lines generated by the vector B. So A plus B. This is not a rectangular coordinate system, right? As you can see, because you don't move by perpendicular lines, you move by lines in a slot. Your squares are actually parallelograms here. So that's one thing that I'm going to try to instill in you. It's going to be very important to understand that parallelogram is really a square in relative to a skewed coordinate system. Okay? Any questions? Some of you look confused. Maybe I just paralleled. No.
Okay.
We'll see. So basically we can think of the way I try to think of positions in space versus vectors, right? I think of a position as just displacement from some origin. So basically, they are very similar. A position is really can be described by how to displace to a location from the origin. A vector is just a displacement that does not take care where you start your journey, right? So if I just specify how to get to a point, to another point, I just say here's where you start, here's where you go. So I draw a line between your start point and your end point. If I want to specify address, I go, let's say, where do you live, right? I go to the to Greenwich Village, that's your center of your coordinate system, and then I draw a line from there to your house. That's the difference between position and displacement, as I described. Okay? So that's the coordinate system you consider. So now we talk about the orthogonal coordinate system. Oh, by the way, before I move on, I'm going to mention that again, but you see that that the vector A and the vector B don't generate the same line. Notice I could have selected a different size vector, but so that the line sticks are really parallel, right? So if the two vectors don't generate the same line, they are called linearly independent. That is a geometric thing that you're going to learn in algebra, but in algebra it's abstract, but you call it linearly independent. Here I hope you see it geometrically. A and B are linearly independent because they generate different lines. They are linearly dependent if A and B generate the same line. in essence, right?
In that case, one would have to be a scalar of the other.
Yes, in that case, one is the scalar of the other. And of course, I'm lying a little bit because you stretch the definition and say, well, 0 is 0 and any other vector are linearly independent, although 0 doesn't generate any number line. But you can think of 0 as a scalar multiple of any other vector, in that sense, right? In other words, 0 times, the 0 scalar times any other vector gives you 0. So any combination of 0 and another vector will be linearly independent by that. All right, so now we talk about the orthogonal coordinate system. Now, orthogonal coordinate system is one where you are very familiar with, right? And what you do is, again, in specifying all possible displacements in the plane, you know, you can see the infinity many of them, right? You notice that it's enough to describe two primitive displacements, and all others can be explained in terms of them, right? So that's what we did to describe all points in this blackboard, right? I could have using those vectors, using those lines, if I generate a grid from this slanted line and that slanted line, if I generate a grid in the manner that you have seen here, that grid will allow me to locate any point on this blackboard or whiteboard. Right? So usually, if there is no purpose in doing otherwise, it's nice to have the grid one line vertical and one line horizontal. And it's nice to have units on those grid to be of the same size. It's usually more appealing. So that's what you do with the rectangular coordinate system. So what you do is you select what's your unit. Again, unit can be anything, inch, centimeter, a meter, a kilometer, whichever you like, right? So by themselves, I mean, there is no description of what you need to use. You have to be careful about it, right? So select a stick that you're going to call unit size. Let's say this is my unit size. So I select that stick. And let's say I want to extend it from this position. Here is that unit stick, right? So basically what you do is you fix a position, you fix what you consider your Greenwich village, your origin. And you draw your unit stick. You draw one that is horizontal and call it I. You draw one that is perpendicular to it and pointing upwards. And call it J. Okay? That is what you, the grid generated by those two vectors attached to a particular point, that's what you call rectangular or orthogonal coordinate system. Okay? In this case, the grid is going to be divided into squares. I mean, so basically, there's a square here, there's a square here, etc. Right? So you can think of a grid made out of squares. So it's called rectangular again because the easiest geometric objects to describe in that space are rectangles. Right? We're going to learn that for when we talk about how to describe rectangles. So in essence, what you usually do when somebody tells you find the point 1.1, right? 1.1 is just the address. So by itself it's meaningless, right? It's an address, so basically if you have directions on how to use the address and where you start with the initial point, then you know that all you have to do is displace, what is that means? It means 1 times I plus 1 times j. And this notation, in other words, usually when this notation is just reserved for pure displacement. And this notation is reserved for location. But what this means is just displaced by the vector I from your origin, and then by the vector j from your origin. Now, of course, you can do it in the other one, first by vector j, then by vector I. If I want to generate a three-dimensional coordinate system, What do I need to do? I notice I only need three vectors, three primitive vectors, in which everything else can be described in their terms. So I actually add another component k. I call it ijk, and I again keep them to be the same size. That's my three-dimensional system. So they can be written as ijk, or eventually, because we're going to be interested in higher dimensions, eventually you run out of letters, or it's inconvenient, you start calling them e1, e2, e3. And then e4, e5, e6, etc. So what distinguishes, it's actually a very complicated topic, but a one-dimensional system is one where you can locate all positions. That's a space where all positions are described by one primitive location, by one primitive direction. Right? That's a line. A two-dimensional system is one where you need two primitive directions to be able to describe everything else in that space. And then three-dimensional, four-dimensional is one where you need three, and then respectively four, primitive directions. Algebraically, the three-dimensional space is denoted by R3, because it's three copies of R, X, Y, and Z. Why are there three copies of R? Because really, by specifying the X direction, or by specifying I, J, and K, I, J, and K, I wonder if I point in the right direction, I never can tell. It doesn't matter, you get my point, right? There is also this problem of left-handed coordinate system and right-handed coordinate system, which just always confuses the hell, directions are not my thing. So, I, J, and K. If I want to specify the address in a three-dimensional space, then I need to travel parallel to the line generated by the vector I, parallel to the line generated by J, and by K. So I need to specify three numbers as in terms of how far I travel along this line generated by I, namely the x-axis, how much I travel along the y-axis, and how much I travel along the z-axis. That's why we have three little numbers specify a location once the coordinate system is given. Right? A three-dimensional system is characterized by that. You need three real numbers. Whatever geometry you pick for your coordinate system, you will need three numbers to specify the location, always. Right? And that's difficult because even if you wonder, there are examples in analysis that show you that, well, some object that you would expect to be two-dimensional appears as one-dimensional. So that dimension is a very complicated thing. But naively speaking, basically no matter what scheme you would pick, if there is a one-to-one and onto representation, in other words, if each house has a unique address, and each house does have an address, right, then it has to be uniquely specified. It has to be three points that specify. This picture just illustrates how to draw inside of a three-dimensional space. Is the flickering bothering you guys? Tolerable? Because it looks like it's getting worse. Okay. So, how do I locate the point A, B, C in that space? So, here's the drawing, right? So what you first do is, in perspective, you try to draw the point A on the x-axis, the point B on the y-axis, and point C on the z-axis. And then first, let's say, take points A and B, and find where the lines drawn out of them intersect. So the line drawn out of A has to be drawn in such that it appears in the picture as parallel to Y. You can see, right? So you draw a line parallel through A, parallel to the Y-axis, and a line through B, parallel to the X-axis. Where they intersect, that's this point. Next, what do? You look at the base of this drawing here, where the two dotted lines intersected, and look at the origin of the coordinate system. And imagine drawing a dotted line right across. Then look at C, you draw a line parallel to the dotted line right across until it meets with the line emanating from the xy plane. and drawn parallel to the z-axis. And that's how you would locate points in. And if you do it correctly, it would look more or less, give the illusion of three dimensions. Right? There are other ideas in perspective geometry that I don't even mention. You don't have to worry about it that much. What the cost? Right, so I'm not sure if I use different notation and I'm never really consistent about using it. But again, back to this topic, distinguishing between vectors and coordinates. So how would you say, what's the difference between a coordinate and a vector? You can vary the units. Again, you can specify 1 meter as your unit or 1 mile as your unit. That's not the issue.
One is a line segment, the other one is just a point.
Coordinates are addresses of geometric points, right? That's how you should think of them, right? So a coordinate is just an address. Now, an address can only be given once you specify the coordinate frame. Okay? Mm-hmm. A vector is a displacement. Now, they are very similar in that sense. I would consider the, basically, if I specify the coordinate system, and I know how to move, how to locate myself using that coordinate system, then I can say that the coordinate is just, if you're using a linear system, in other words, where you displace by lines, a coordinate point, a coordinate will be just a description of how I need to displace from the origin to get to a point, from the origin of the coordinate system, right? A displacement is just mentioning how to travel from any point to any other point, right? So basically, coordinates is just a particular displacement. You can think of coordinates as particular displacement from the origin. Okay? So notationally, coordinates are usually written with circle brackets, A, B, C. But usually a lot of people would be just, they sometimes denote vectors this way, sometimes they denote coordinates this way, right? So they usually just leave it to you to decide if it's a vector or if it's a coordinate point. Again, usually vectors are just geometric things. When you think of a vector purely, right, you think of a stick. For calculus, right? Later on, a vector is just an element of a vector space. It's an element inside of a structure that has algebra. So a vector literally is just a stick that has direction. It's a stick that points somewhere. Okay. So when I designate a coordinate by ABC, what I mean is that I have some notion of primitive directions and some sort of notion of length, and ABC is just basically the address of moving by some displacement along the x-axis in this case, then some displacement B along the y-axis, then some displacement C along the z-axis, all from the origin. You begin from the origin of the coordinate system, right? Whereas the vector, you can write it as A times I plus B times J plus C times K. A vector means, well, select any location and then move from that location, take it out to be your origin, move by displacement of A units parallel to the vector I, B units parallel to the vector J, C units parallel to the vector K. But if you specify a vector, you specify a displacement. So you don't necessarily need to specify where the displacement started. That didn't have to start at the origin. So sometimes I'm actually not always doing that. I will designate vectors by the triangular brackets if we want to specify, well, displacement ABC. That entails that we have a coordinate system, and I describe the displacement in terms of that coordinate system. Right? As opposed to circle brackets where that is a vector. But really, I'm not really thorough with that procedure, so it's up to you to eventually decide if it's a vector or scalar. So for instance, by that notation, what I mean is P1, P2, P3 in circle brackets plus ABC, what it means is here is the tail, here is the place where I start, so that's the coordinate of where I start, plus ABC. Right? So that's the same as taking the vector from the origin, P1, P2, P3, and then adding to it ABC. And that will give you the new location. So this plus that gives you location. So if I were consistent, basically, right, here's what would happen. So we're going to learn how to add vectors in a moment. But P1, P2, P3 plus ABC, the result has to be a point. Something here, something here, something here. Because it's a point, and then there's a displacement from it, and then where we end up is another point. So I'm just talking about it in terms of addresses. All right. So in this next segment, we try to understand how to add vectors. Algebraic, rather than just putting one on top of the other. So, if I let's say want to add three-dimensional vectors, I can describe all of them by the unit perpendicular ones, by I, which is just the generator of the x-axis, by j, which is generating the perpendicular y-axis, and k, which generates z. Right? So any vector can be then described by how much you need to displace by I, j, and k. Hopefully that's intuitively clear to you for three-dimensional space. So for instance, if I have this vector here, right, I can measure how much I need to displace here, here, and here to arrive at this location, right? So I break it down. Instead of doing this direct displacement, I displace always parallel to the x, parallel to y, and parallel to z. And that's how I describe this vector as the sum of unit vectors. So if I have one vector a, so let's describe A as A1, A2, A3. That's a displacement here. And that displacement is the same as what this means is in our case, it means A1i plus A2j plus A3k. Okay? In other words, I described this stick that points somewhere in space in terms of how to displace by moving parallel to x, y, and z. Now let's look at vector b. So any vector b will have another description, b1, b2, b3, that is if the vector is inside of my, it fits inside of my three-dimensional coordinate thing. So that is b1i plus b2j plus b3k. Now suppose I want to add them. What is obtained? Now you see, I now describe them in terms of the primitives, right? So I have three different vectors plus three different vectors. So because of the properties that we learned about, geometric properties of addition of vectors, I can group them so that like vector is added to like vector. So I can do the addition like this. See what I did? I just rearranged them based on the geometry that I briefly glossed over in the this chapter, I learned that I can arrange them in any way I want before adding. So there's commutativity. I can just, if I have one vector plus another, I can always switch the order in which I add. And there is associativity. I can choose any two to add first and then add the remaining ones. So that's what the previous steps established. If you think about it, they established that for any number of additions. That's kind of not so easy. So now that we rearranged, what is this plus that? We can use the fact that I can factor out I. I can use the law of distributivity. So the end result is that we have here a1 plus b1 and the vector I plus a2 plus b2 times the vector j plus a3 plus b3 times the vector k. And in terms of the notation, then I can write it as a1 plus b1, a2 plus b2, a3 plus b3. In other words, to add two vectors, if I know if I can describe them in components, it's enough to add each component. So the first to first, second to second, third to third. Okay? But you see, it follows from this joint. All right. Similarly, I can ask what it means to multiply. How would algebraically it look like when I multiply? Yeah, I can erase that. Now suppose I have this vector, and I want to see what scalar multiplication looks like. So for instance, if I have this and I multiply t times a. T times a means the scalar t times the sum a1i plus a2j plus a3k. Now, scalar multiplication, basically the scalar can be distributed. Like in regular multiplication, you can distribute the scalar through sum. Again, guys, I encourage you to think about the draw diagrams, etc. This is not obvious. You need to see geometrically where that happens. So then we have TA1i plus TA2j plus TA3k. So if you can translate it into the new description, that means it's really TA1, TA2, TA3. So look at it. In other words, what is that equal to? That's equal to t times a1, a2, a3. So you see that the correct algebraic procedure to multiply a scalar times a vector is really to multiply each component by the same scalar. Understand, please do me the favor and do this comprehension exercise. So we have the vector A and the vector B and some scalar C, which is 1/2. I want you to carry out those procedures, A plus B, constant C times B, and B minus A. Carry them algebraically.
Is that 19k?
That's for the, you see, I think it's 14. Yeah, I think it's 14, but really, who cares?
That's
14. We'll figure out what it is later, right?
Sure.
It is minus g.
This is 10i minus j plus, I believe, 14k, but we'll verify. it's weird looking. Basically, that's how I write 4, so I'm assuming it's working. It's not flickering a little, or
like
it's
not.
Can you see?
It is not.
Hopefully our class will have the right projector. It's going to be in another class. Again, guys, don't torture yourself with calculating. All I want is to see that you can carry the operation, that you know what to do. All right, guys. So let's see what we do. So yes, it was 14, as you can see here. All right. So in this notation with those triangle brackets, we have 10 minus 1, 14. I hate to write this. Okay. So we have that. Again, you see they mean the same. And then when I add, I just really need to take the first component to the first component. Second component, I add to the second component of the other vector, etc. Right? So the end result is 16. Then that's the first coordinate, then 6 and 6. Good? Now what happens in 2? I need to multiply 6, 7, minus 8 by 1 half. So that would be 6 times 1 half, which is 3. 7 times 1 half, which is 7 over 2, and minus 8 times 1 half, which is minus 4, and that's the other way of writing the vector. Now, what does it mean to take b minus 8? B minus 8 is the same as b plus the number minus 1 multiplied by a. So that's the same as taking each component and subtracting, right? So we have 6 minus 10, it's minus 4, 7 minus 1, which is 8, minus 8 minus 14, which is minus 22. Good? And again, guys, so you see those things? It's not only important to be able to carry those exercises. They are only to illustrate if you understand. The most important thing is if you can explain why this works this way. So, the next topic is how to find the algebraic expression for displacement. So, in other words, remember what's the difference between a vector and, once you have a coordinate system, the difference between a vector and the addressed coordinate location is, the coordinate location is displacement from the origin of the system, whereas a vector will just represent just a generic displacement. So suppose that I want to find a displacement between a point whose address is 1 minus 2 relative to the rectangular coordinate system, and the other point B, which is whose address is 3, 1. Right? So what do we have? We have that B is really displacement by the vector B from the origin. So 3, 1 is really 3 times I plus 1 times J, where the point from which I start the displacement is 0, 0. It's the origin of that system. Right? And similarly, the vector A, that whose tail is at the origin, gives you the address of point capital A. Right? What I need is displacement, how to travel from A to B. So I need the vector B. So B is B1, B2. Now if you look at it, what's happening here? We have A plus B gives you the vector B. Right? Or another way of saying that is that B minus A is that vector. B minus A is the vector B. So the answer is 3, 1, minus 1, minus 2, and the vector is 2, comma 3, which is 2i plus 3j. Yeah? this has to be very clear, because you see the fact that they complete the triangle, it's going to be our basis for explaining dot product in one pointer.
But can you do that vice versa as well?
If I want displacement from B to A,
yes,
then I take A minus B. Right. So the thing about it is to see that if I want to draw the vector B minus A, it would be a vector that completes the triangle, and then to know where the head points. The head always points to the vector from which you subtract. So if it's B minus A, the head of vector B will point to B, just like in this picture. If it's A minus B, the vector will be just the same, but anti-parallel, pointing towards capital A. Clear? And so again, just when you draw this, try to argue like before geometrically why this vector is indeed B minus A. In three-dimensional space, there is nothing special. It's exactly the same idea. I mean, the drawing is made, you can see what happens, right? So you just displace by some vector A and vector B, and you have this B. If you look at it from the right perspective, it would appear to you just like the triangle before. And just like in vector addition before, it's exactly the same. It's B minus A. Anyone confused?
So then first you,
here is what I'm saying. So let's see that in three-dimensional space this way, right? Again, maybe I don't have, excellent. You see, I have a natural vector here, right? Here. Here is two vectors in three-dimensional space. Let's say this is the origin of the coordinate system, right? So let's say this is B and this is A. So would anybody want to come to me and try to produce the vector, just show me where the vector B minus A is? Anybody comes up and just show me where that vector is.
B minus A?
So then waiver your rights for your identity.
Which one is A? Which one is B?
Okay.
This is B. The longer one is B, and the shorter one is A, and I want B minus A.
Tip to tip. The vector connects.
Yeah, tip to tip, right? You see, so if this is the origin, this point, this displacement from the origin represents the address of the point B. And this vector represents the address of point A. So tip to tip, where is that going to be? So where is going to be the tip of that vector? On the shorter or longer? Longer. If it's B minus A, the vector will point this way.
Well, again, I'm just speculating, but I believe it might look something like this. Like that. And then the resultant vector should be here. No.
You can do that. You can do that. You can do that this way as well, right? You can do that this way as well. There are many ways of drawing the same vector. Don't assume that that's a unique procedure, right? It's just that you have to understand this procedure because you have to see how the law of cosines is going to generate the dot product in chapter 1.2. But other procedures will basically one way to say what is B minus A is you see this is the vector A. You just take this. You flip it over, and then you shift it, and you place it here. And then you have this vector here. That's a parallel procedure, right? Another thing, which is I just explained, right? Because that's how addition works, right? You should come up with this procedure yourself. Another thing to do is the vector B minus A is, it has to be a vector that completes this triangle. Why? Because B minus A is going to be a vector C. And what should C satisfy? C should satisfy the property that A plus C is B. A plus C is equal to B. C would be that difference, right? So A plus C is B. That means that C has to point towards the head of the vector from which you subtract. Is that clear?
Yes.
So that's what this drawing is illustrating. Right? And if you can represent something in coordinates, then naturally you can just as before look at the coordinates. P minus A, it's B1 minus A1, B2 minus A2, that was in two dimensions, and in three dimensions it would be B1 minus A, here the vector is A1, A2, A3, that's the displacement from the origin, that's why it's coordinates, right? And B is B1, B2, B3, the vector B is B1 minus A1, B2 minus A2, B3 minus A3. Okay, so again, just like before, and the same idea would work for higher dimensions. It's a bit harder to imagine that geometrically, but it should work. Finally, we need to talk about distance between points in R3. All right, so that's a nice drawing of it. So first, we have the Pythagorean triangle. Before we do that for R3, let's consider the Pythagorean triangle. So if I'm on the plane, and we have the coordinates A1, A2, B1, B2, what is the distance formula? So I'm assuming A1, A2 is in the triangle coordinates, of course, right? What is the distance formula? Well, I can break it into two vectors. Here is one vector, and here is another vector. What is this vector here? How much do I have to displace? In other words, I need to know what is this point. What is this point?
A2 minus A1.
To be precise, it's A1 plus B1 minus A1. So in other words, this the first coordinate, and then A2, the second coordinate, and then you can simplify it as simply B1 A2. You see that? In other words, what I'm saying is, from the position A1 displaced by a vector B1 minus A1 times I. That gives you this position. So it's B1, A1. Now, in the Pythagorean triangle, then what you do is you just have to measure this length, square it, measure that length, square it, and then that would give you the square of the missing length. You should know the proof of a Pythagorean theorem, at least of a simple one. I can show you a simple one. How many of you know a simple proof of the Pythagorean theorem? Proof. In other words, if you have to explain why.
Well, there's the one with the two squares, right? The geometric one.
Oh, there are many. I mean, but here I'll show you a very, very simple proof of the Pythagorean theorem. I guess let's do that before we move on. You can't not know the Pythagorean theorem, right?
Knowing
means that you can explain why it works.
I just can come up with a proof on
the top of my head. So hopefully this one will be so simple that you would be able to construct it, right? So let's begin with a triangle. This is A, and this is B. It's a right triangle. Now what I can do with this triangle, I'm not sure if I'll be able to draw it very well. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take this triangle, and I'm going to rotate it 90 degrees and place it here. Rotating it 90 degrees means that this side is A, and then this side is B. Right? And this missing side is C. Now, I take the same triangle, I rotate it again 90 degrees. So if I rotate this 90 degrees again, A is going to be adjacent to B, right? Basically, the extension of B is A. that would be B. Now rotating it again 90 degrees, this would be again A, B, and this is C. Right? Now let's look at it, right? I mean, I'm not sure if the drawing is good enough, but you see that we have a very big square. The big square, what's the area of the big square? In terms of A and B, of course. A plus B square. So we have that A plus B squared. Now my goal is to find the area of basically C squared. C squared is the area of the, you can actually verify by measuring the angles that that's the thing that they constructed inside is actually a square. Its area is C squared. So C squared is just the same thing as the area of the big square minus the area of the triangle, of each triangle, right? So it's minus 4 times the area of, because this is the same triangle, it's minus 4 times the area of one copy of the triangle. What's the area of the triangle?
One half base times height.
Yeah, one half base times height. So base is, let's say, A, and height is B, doesn't really matter, right? So one half base times height, so the end result is, if I expand this, I get A squared plus 2AB plus B squared minus 2AB, and that is my C squared. Now what am I left? I'm just left with A squared plus B squared. So that's a very simple proof of the Pythagorean theorem. It was not available during the time of Pythagoras because they did not associate geometry, as you Greek know, don't associate geometry with numbers. Right? Their notion of numbers was completely geometric. So this proof would not be available. But it's very easy. Pythagorean theorem is really the reason we use this. Basically, we use that distance for. So now, if I have 2 points here, is a1, a2, and b1, b2. If those points correspond to a rectangular coordinate, if I'm on a rectangular coordinate, then I can take this line segment and I can extend it to generate a right triangle. The length here, the length of this line segment is absolute value of what? B1 minus A1. You see, I drew it this way, but you don't know how it's oriented. So really, really, you just use the picture to interpolate what should be the general situation. B1 minus A1. And this length here is?
B2 minus A2.
Okay, so I hope you see that, right? So basically, if I move horizontally, right? All that is going to be changed is the vertical component doesn't change, right? If I move horizontally, only the horizontal component, A1, is changed. Or A1 corresponds to I, A1 times I. So moving there, I have A1 plus some segment gives me B1. So obviously, what I need to add is B1 minus A1 together. So I have to displace B1 minus A1. So then, what's the size of C? We know that C squared is absolute value of b1 minus a1 squared plus b2 minus a2 squared. That's the Pythagorean theorem. It's the interpreted now in coordinates, right? So that means that the distance c, that's the length, right, is just the root. Notice, because it's absolute value squared, I can just as well remove the absolute value and keep it as open brackets, right? b1 minus a1 squared plus b2 minus a2 squared. Good? That's how it's done in R2. That's the usual metric, which then I have to win people off once you're in analysis, because then you will use all sorts of metrics. You use the Stumpf metric, which is the Manetti metric, right? Which measures distances in a very different way. All right, but for now, this picture is telling you how you would see that in R3, really, it's all the same, right? In R3, you just have to see how the displacement from A to B, its size, can be just described in the same way. You can just create a triangle. Okay? And once you create a triangle, here's the analysis, you can go over it at home. Once you create the analysis, you realize that the way length is going to work is that it's going to be root of b1 minus a1. So in other words, if we have points here, the point A has coordinates a1, a2, a3, and the point B here has coordinates b1, b2, b3. The displacement, the size of the displacement, the length, is root of b1 minus a1 squared plus b2 minus a2 squared plus b3 minus a3 squared. So that you should analyze this drawing, right? Because what you can do is you can just take those points, you can project, you can measure this side of the triangle, which you can do by the Pythagorean theorem in R2. And then we have this extra thing that is measured against the z-axis. And altogether, once you work it through, as I do here, you see that you get a similar looking business model. Now, so that tells us how to measure the size of a vector, right? So a vector is just a displacement. So we might as well select the displacement from the origin, since all the other displacements are of the same size. So if a vector is a displacement a1i plus a2j plus a3k, the size of the vector now, the norm that we just before you only used a symbol for, is going to be root of a1 squared plus a2 squared plus a3 squared. Is that clear? Because it's really a1 minus 0 squared plus a2 minus 0 squared plus a3 minus 0 squared. Now let's see how the norm behaves under scalar multiplication. So if I select any real number t and multiply by the vector, remember that multiplying vector by t is the same as distributing the scalar to each component. So that's what we have here. So the size of that vector is just going to be a root of parentheses t times a1 squared plus parentheses t times a2 squared plus t times a3 squared. And I can factor this squared out. And I can use that property of roots, that if I have a product of two numbers, root of a product is the same as the product of the roots. So then it's root of t squared. Notice, very importantly, root of t squared is not t. Root of minus 1 squared is not minus 1. Right? So root of t squared is absolute value of t times the norm. Cool? So from there, right away, we try to figure out how do we obtain the unit vector notation, right? So basically, here is a vector. Let's say this is what I consider to be size 1. And here is a vector that they have, right? Now, what's the size of that vector? If this is size 1, this is 3. right? Here, as you can see, this is 1, 2, 3, etc. Right? So how do I take this vector? How do I, out of this, imagine I have this description of this vector in R3, and I want to figure out how to normalize it. In other words, how to find a vector that points in the same direction but has size 1.
Multiply it by a third.
Multiply it by a third in this case. But in general, what do I do? In general, let's say I cannot see just by some line segment, I cannot see how much is it relative to that 1 unit. Right? So the general thing that I do is we can use that property that we established, right? So generally, I need to multiply my vector by some scalar. I need to trim it down or scale it up depending on its size. So I multiply it by some scalar such that the norm of the vector times the scalar, by the scalar is positive, right? Because I don't want to change the direction. If I want to keep the direction, I always multiply by only positive scalars. So I multiply by some scalar t times v, and such that when I take the norm, I will get 1. By what we just learned, you can always factor the scalar under absolute value. So norm of t times v is the same as absolute value of t times v. Now t is positive, so absolute value doesn't do anything. Right? So we have 1 is equal to t times the norm of v. What does it mean? It means now we have just an equation in scalars. If I now take, I solve this equation, I have that t is 1 over norm of v. So that tells me that if I take a vector and multiply the vector by 1 over its norm, I get a unit vector. Okay? If you understand this, please do this exercise, comprehension check. So my vector is 3i minus 4j plus k. I want you to normalize. In other words, I want you to find a vector that points in the same direction but is shorter or longer. I don't know, right? Actually, it has to be shorter. Okay? It has to be of size 1. And can you see the solution? Yeah. So here's what you do. So first you just calculate the size of that vector. The size of that vector is just root of the sum of the squares of the components, right? So it's root of 3 squared plus minus 4 squared plus 1, which is the root of 26. And then all you need to do is just take the vector a and divide by that norm. right? And that will just scale it up, just like we solved that general equation, that will scale it up to be precisely of size 1. You can see it's size 1 here. So if you take each component squared and add the squares, you'll get 1. Alright, guys, so are you collapsing or you have a little bit more energy?
I'm collapsing.
Collapsing? Anybody else? Since I'm collapsing? It's okay, it's your fault. Me too, I'm hungry and tired. If you have to, what's the question, Dash?
А, нет, просто хочу знать, продолжать снимать или нет.
Продолжай снимать.
Окей, давай.
Let's just talk about lines a little bit. So, I mean, here is, 19 is really the reason where I deviate already in that chapter from the regular introduction from that conference. Okay? So, again, we're back to trying to understand how to describe lines in three-dimensional space. So that's our first example of a parametric curve. So what is a line? How can you think of a line? Imagine that what you do is you specify some point in space called capital A, and you have a particle that moves with constant speed or uniform velocity, traced in some direction, as in this picture. Right? So that is how the line will be generated. So that constant velocity v means that in one moment of time it would reach the displacement of from A by 1 times the velocity. And then 2 times the velocity and onwards, right? So we have a number line that we generated here in space. Always nice, it's just a number line with 1, 2, 3, etc. That's the simplest description of that line. But if you want to explain what this line is in terms of the x, y, z coordinate system, then you need to translate what it means to be on this line into what it means to be in the overall space. So the point capital A, I gave it coordinates a1, a2, a3, which means that in order to get to capital A from the origin of the coordinate system, I need to displace by A1 times I plus A2 times J plus A3 times K. That's how I will displace from here to here, right? So that's the translation in coordinates of the point A, which is geometric point in space, that's its address. Now, the vector V, the displacement vector, can also be described in three-dimensional space, so I describe it as V1, V2, V3. Times t, right? And this point plus t times that point shall give you a point whose address is given here. So the idea is then, okay, if I have this point translated to the address plus t times the description of the vector, that now gives you a description that looks like that. A1 plus tv1, a2 plus tv2, a3 plus tv3. Notice that each component exactly looks like the equation of a line. Okay. So really, it's a parametric curve because you don't describe the line in terms of just x, y, and z. You introduce an extra parameter. You introduce the parameter t in this case. Now, t is, so basically x of t, that tells you what's the relative position on the point when you travel with this velocity, relative to the x-axis, relative to y-axis, and relative to the z-axis. Okay? One small question. Is this line that we have here, what's the dimension of it?
One.
It's really the proper thing to say is that it is a one-dimensional object submerged in a three-dimensional space. Right? What is the dimension of this? So if I draw the letter S first, so what's the dimension of the letter S? How many people say it's 2? So if I consider S, And again, you see, if you remember the name of the game, it's actually very hard to always explain what's the dimension of an object, but the idea is that you need to specify, basically, what's the minimum number of parameters that you need to specify to be able to locate yourself inside of that object, right? So imagine that you are an ant living in that space, and you're not able to walk out of that curve, right? You're on the curve. what's the minimum number of coordinates you need to specify to that ant so it will be able to locate itself in that space. Two? So how many of you say two? One person does.
I know it's one, but something.
It's good that you know it's one, right? So why do you say two? It is one. One, because you see, if you were to select the right coordinate system, we're going to consider it a little bit, right? Those are they're not linear, right? And basically, what you imagine is take a directed stick and now twist it into S, right? Basically, it has numbers on it. Here's one, here's two, here's three. So what you can do is you can take it and you can twist it like a piece of metal, right? And by twisting it, you would actually you're able to assign a unique address to each point on S. That's the, basically, in other words, there's a relative coordinate system with respect to which it's very easy to describe.
So is it actually like a train track? A bit like a...
It's like a train track.
Like the sixth train, for instance?
Like the sixth train, yes.
Okay, okay.
Which you could have taken at 14th. So here is an example. Find, let's try if you can do that, and soon we'll finish, right? Find the equation of the line passing through the point 1, 0, 0. In other words, you can take 1, 0, 0 as your starting point of the line in the direction j. And then decide, is the point 1, 5, 3 on the line? So let's do it. So the way you do that is, okay, this is the point where you begin, and this is the displacement. The displacement is j, which is the same as 0, 1, 0. So what you do is you describe the parametric displacement as a plus d times b. You see, it even has the same expression as a line. Remember a line in elementary school, it was intercept plus a number variable times another times the slope. So v plays the same role as a slope. Going to be generalized, right? So we have a plus t times v is going to be this plus t times that, which is the same as 1 t 0. Now the question is 1, 5, 3, is it on this line?
So in this case, we just assume t is 1, right? So we say, okay, we've got this vector, and our scalar in this case is 1.
Is just basically if t is varying from minus infinity to plus infinity, right? Okay. Because the line has to be, basically t is just telling you where you are at any given moment of time, right? Mm-hmm. So the way you imagine, if you were to describe it in a computer, what you would see is a particle that is just moving in space. Mm-hmm. You would actually see the particle that is moving in space, and the actual line, to be precise, is just what the particle traces. It's not the motion of the particle, right? This is just the kinematic equation of a particle moving with constant velocity.
Okay, so you just say, okay, t takes on all real numbers.
All real numbers.
And so the line extends.
Yeah.
As t takes on.
Yeah, so basically this is a line, basically, this is a line measured in units. Basically, one unit of this line is really this location displaced by j, right? So this line is traced, basically, if this is I, this is j, this line is moving this way. So there is some point and the line is moving this way. If this is my coordinate system, right? And this is my initial point, the line is going to be moving. And that's the description. So it's 1, x of t is 1 because it doesn't change its x position at all, because it only changes, it only displaces in the direction of v. Y of t is t, in other words, it's, the displacement is linear, just directly related to t, and z of t is 0, according to this. Is this 0.153, is it ever visited by the particle?
No.
No, why not?
Because you can't come up with a value of t that sets x.
Exactly. So you see, notice 1 is fine, right? If t is equal to 5, then this point is also matched.
Yeah.
But I can never match the point 3. Yeah. Because this line is characterized by the fact that the first component is always 1. So the line is never changed relative to the x-axis. It never changed relative to the z-axis. Only changes relative to the y-axis, so that's 0. Okay. All right, guys. I guess I should stop here so that I don't overwhelm you. And thank you very much for waiting for quite a while. All right. So if you still have the energy, you can come next Sunday. And on Tuesday, it's not film, but just come. We can talk about physics if you want to talk about physics. I'm not going to teach, so the thing is you have to read it and we'll just talk about the question, discuss the question.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so it will be too hard to just go through the book and teach it, I suppose. So you just read it and I'll help you read it.